What is up, Cardboard Nation? Welcome back to another episode of Go GTS Live, the Hobbies web show. I'm your host, Rob Bertrand. Joining me as always, Chris Stuber. What's up, brother?
What's up, Rob? How you doing, my man?
I'm doing well. Look at you, sporting the gear.
Gotta do it. Tomorrow night. Yeah, I'm excited. I'm very, very excited. So.
Well, I'm rooting for the Phillies because I'm rooting for you.
I appreciate that. No, and hopefully the whole nation is rooting for the Phillies as well, because does anyone like the Astros? I mean,
well, I still
get the garbage cans out. Come on. I mean,
I still can't accept the fact that they're not a National League team. That
it's
was
different. Yeah,
that was the most bizarre. I mean, there's realignment and then there's like, whoa, you know, that one just threw me for a loop. That one threw me for a loop.
But, you know, they're a really good team. It should be a great series. Obviously, you know where my rooting interests lie. I'm just hoping for a good series. I'm hoping for a big win. We'll see.
All right. All right. Well, we've got a big show for you. I would say, as always, but this one is, I think, a little bit bigger than normal. Last week, we had very few hobby happenings. This week, we have a lot of hobby happenings. We've also got a special part one of an interview with Soccer Cards United, a couple of lads from Ireland across the pond that I had an opportunity to speak with earlier this week. And so we'll check in with them. And we've got four box breaks for you, including a trifecta from Panini and what could be a world debut of Hero DC Unlocked, the Multiverse, Black Adam.
Nice.
We say could be because we're not absolutely sure. The release date was kind of fluid.
Yes.
And
yeah,
we knew when it was supposed to release, but then David Adams still has it on pre-sale, and so we don't know. But we've got a box, and you're going to get to
check it out.
That's
all that matters, though, Rob. We have a box. That's a good thing.
That's right.
Yeah.
We've also got a couple of special video segments for you, got a vendor spotlight and a cool giveaway and a whole lot more. But first and foremost, Chris,
yes.
Go GTS Live Q of the Week poll.
Yes. Do you submit cards for grading? And the simple thing is yes or no. And right now we have 62.9% with the no and 37.1% with the yes. 105 votes with 1 hour left.
Okay. We wanted to know because it's going to tie into something later in the program.
Yep.
So if you haven't had an opportunity to weigh in on the poll question, please do so. Find us on Twitter at GoGTSLive. We did get some responses, of course, as always, to our polls. So in Would We Trust said, I haven't. I tend to sell them quicker raw. Kibu 0629 Kirsten said, not yet, but I have happily bought and traded for slab cards over the past 5 years, and I do plan on submitting a few in the future. Christopher Brown said, I literally have a stack of cards halfway up my legs in need of grading. I'm just saving up the money to do a bulk submission. Well, take advantage of one of those opportunities with Beckett, who on a 30 to 45 day turnaround has $18, I believe, right now.
It's pretty good.
It's not going to get any lower than that.
No.
I can almost guarantee you those days have flown the coop. I was surprised that $20 came back, and to have it even sub 20 really surprised me. And that's why I told you about that, I think, just last week. Only thing grading is good for is protection, Ted Dastic Jr. Well, I would.
Well,
I would disagree with that almost completely.
Yeah, there's a lot of other.
Yeah, they are good for protection, but almost always someone's going to pay a higher value for a card.
ROI is what grading is about as well.
Absolutely, absolutely, and that's why you don't necessarily need to slab your PC cards. If you have a card you're keeping forever, why not spend it on something that you're eventually maybe going to flip? That's kind of the, and Ivan was the one that kind of made me see the smarts in that, if you will.
Sure.
I know you grade
Yes.
And have you submitted anything recently?
I haven't recently. I do have a lot of cards that I could get graded. I think I'm just waiting for, I guess, you know, the $20 per card is what I like. That seems to be what I used to spend.
Little sweet spot.
Did things for with PSA and, you know, even Beckett. But, you know, I have a huge stack of cards that I could send in. But I'm just waiting a little bit. I think, you know, I think people would agree with me that the market in terms of selling on the secondary market has slowed down in terms of value and what people are looking to spend on cards, unless it's something big and they really need it. But some of those, I guess, mid-tier to lower-tier cards that could have the potential to make a little bit of a boom in the coming months or years or whatever it may be, they may not get the most bang for the buck at this point, but...
So you're in no rush.
No rush at this point, but I have gotten some cards graded, I would say, about 5 months ago that were a little bit more top dollar.
Okay. Bleed Cub Blue 311 said, this times a million. Which was in reply to Greg Riersma, who said, rarely, on occasion, when I can afford it.
Right.
And so I think, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, Greg, but not getting any cheaper than $18.
You're not, no. If you can get it for $18 per card, that's really, really good, especially if it's with one of the top grading companies.
Now, they do get you because there is usually a minimum submission of between
25 or 30.
I think it's 20 cards on each level. So yeah, 18 times 20 is still what, you know, $360. So
sure,
I don't
not cheap.
Have that just sitting around either to spend on graded cards right now.
Right. And I look at that too, is like, okay, do I want to spend $360 on grading? Or do I want to spend $360 on some more cards?
And that was always my thing about it too. I was like, you know, I'd rather just buy more cards.
If it was a very like, you know, robust and fruitful market at this point, I would say do it on the grading side. But now where it's a little bit more advantageous to maybe use your money to get cards in a little bit of a cheaper market, it may be a little bit better idea to do that. But, you know, everyone's different. Every collector is different in how they go about it. I can understand why people want their cards graded or just to get more cards. So whatever floats your boat is the way I go about it. So that's a good thing.
Awesome. And our last commenter so far, Lil Quack 1976 said once. Does that count as a yes? I'm going to say no, because the way the question is phrased, do you submit more present tense?
Yeah. It's
have you submitted.
Right.
Do you submit?
So basically he wants to get them submitted?
No, he said once he has.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I hear you.
I said, I'm going to say no on that.
That's fine. Yeah.
All right. Again, if you haven't done so already, please weigh in. We'll update the poll question later in the program. But for now, as I mentioned previously, we do have several topics to discuss.
Yes.
In this week's Hobby Happening segment with news, notes, and nuggets from around the web. And unfortunately, we have several crime and legal notes this week. First, a Pennsylvania man has been sentenced to incarceration after an investigation into him scamming a man from Australia. It can't easily get here and beat you up.
No.
Scammed a man out of Australia tens of thousands of dollars in basketball cards. Yeah. Michael Benjamin, 37, was sentenced to incarceration in the Bradford County Correctional Facility for 6 months to 42 months, followed by probation of another term of 18 months, according to the Bradford County District's Attorney's Office. The sentencing comes after an investigation into incidents that occurred in Tuscarora Township and Athens Township in both 2020 and 2021. Benjamin was ordered by the Bradford County DA to pay restitution of $50,327 in addition to that jail sentence for the offenses of theft by deception, felony three, theft deception, felony three, receiving stolen property, and felony three, retail theft. So don't be a hobby tool. All right.
It seems like there's a lot more of those these days because we have another one coming up as well. Meanwhile, in neighboring New York, a Rochester area man is charged with defrauding trading cards buyers and sellers of more than $33,000. Federal prosecutors said Thursday, from October 2021 to February of 2022, Kyle Bertrand, 34.
Darn it, Kyle. Really? You truly are the black sheep of the family, dude. No, I'm joking. There's no relation that I
know. I don't believe you. Well, it seems Kyle faked payments as the buyer and as the seller, shipped empty boxes to people he met online, convincing them he was interested in buying or selling valuable football, basketball, and baseball cards worth thousands of dollars, according to the news released by U.S. Attorney's Office for the Western District of New York. In total, Bertrand defrauded $33,360. I know, Rob, you hate hearing your name in this kind of news, from buyers and sellers in Florida, Ohio, Missouri, and Pennsylvania, prosecutors said. He was charged with wire and mail fraud, prosecutors said as well. He faces a maximum sentence of 20 years in prison. So, Rob, you may not be seeing your nephew for a long, long time.
What's so funny about what you just said about hearing my name is that as I'm reading the article, in the last two sentences where I changed it to he was charged with and he faces, the article said Bertrand, and it said Bertrand. And I'm like, it's a little bit of overkill on the Bertrand already, okay?
They keep on highlight how many times, and you know what? Or just cut out the article and frame it.
Every once in a while.
Put it in the family scrapbook. That would be fun to just look back at.
Now, this next crime story is truly awful and one we've never reported on in this context before. And I have a vague recollection of meeting this person. The owner of the popular Blue Nose collectible shop in Montreal and his partner are dead. And more awful still, their son has been charged in the killing. Wayne Arnott and Louise Boucher were found dead last Wednesday night. The couple's son, Mitchell Arnott, has been charged with two counts of murder. Our thoughts and prayers go out to their family and friends. You hear stories like this, and while sad that there's no connection, right? Well, City News in Montreal spoke with several people who do have a connection. Watch this.
And I talked to him 4 days ago, and I can't believe that he's not here anymore.
Tributes pouring in outside the Blue Nose, a collectible store on Montreal's West Island. Its owner, Wayne Arnott, and his partner, Louise Boucher, were killed Wednesday. Their son was charged with their deaths. Many are in disbelief over the tragedy and losing a pillar in the community.
You see headlines in, you know, online, in newspapers, whatever, and it's always faces that you don't recognize. And when it's, you know, you see someone that you recognize, it really hits home.
Especially when it is someone that did help you out to build up a part of your childhood. It's just, it really hits you hard.
The couple, 60-year-old Wayne and 65-year-old Louise, were stabbed to death at their Il Bizarre home. Their 29-year-old son, Mitchell, charged with second-degree murder, some believing he may have been struggling with his mental health.
Wayne and Louise had a daughter, and she's left picking up a million pieces now. I mean, she's lost essentially a brother, and she's lost her parents, all with one telephone call.
Many now honoring the couple's memory, described as an incredible force.
He was always in motion. He had great energy, but when he did stop, he always had time, especially even for the young collectors. That's what impressed me.
I used to come in and buy little PS1 games and just like old little relics that you just can't find anywhere anymore. And I would just talk to him, and he remembered my name, remembered who I was, you know, he remembered what I did for a living, and he was such a great guy, so happy all the time.
Wayne was like a mentor to me. Taught me a lot, and I know I wasn't the only one, because when I would go in, I would wait my turn.
I was working on a story some months back on Fred Stanfield, a former member of the Boston Bruins, and we had talked about a card that I wanted to get anyway. I wound up finding some ratty old card, and as I was leaving the store, he said, "What have you bought from me today?" And I showed him the Stanfield card. He said, "I'm going to have a really hard time parting with this," and he burst out laughing. So I decided to return the card to him today. I've taped it in a note on the door with my sympathies and expressing my sympathies, and that Wayne will definitely be missed.
Flowers and cards left outside the place where Wayne built his legacy.
We're hoping for the best, that maybe Blue Nose itself will remain strong after his passing, or that there will be peace with Wayne and his family.
In Montreal, Alicia Rubertucci, City.
Sports Collectors Daily reports that two men are accused of stealing more than $75,000 worth of sports cards for stores in Kentucky and Tennessee. A federal grand jury in Kentucky on Thursday indicted Coy Lee Best, 35, of Friendsville, Tennessee, and Thomas Zebulon Casemeyer, 33, of Blount County, Tennessee, on charges of conspiracy and the interstate transportation of stolen goods. According to the court documents from the U.S. District Court for the Eastern District of Kentucky, the two men stole cards from stores specializing in sports cards and memorabilia, taking merchandise worth thousands of dollars. Prosecutors alleged that Lee and Casemeyer resold the stolen goods to other sport card businesses in other cities and states. The burglaries were spread across an 8-month period beginning in May of 2021. The indictment states that the two men must forfeit any of the merchandise taken and or any money derived from any of the sales, an amount equal to gross proceeds in aggregate of obtained by the defendants as a result of the alleged thefts. If convicted of conspiracy charges, Casemeyer and Best face up to 5 years in prison. The interstate transportation charge is punishable by a maximum of 10 years in prison.
It's always that interstate that really, yes.
Yeah.
really ups your stupidity.
Yeah. Just don't go to a different state. But just don't steal in general. Don't steal in general.
Yeah. Okay. I really tried to remain silent on this topic, but after this tweet and subsequent article from a pretty well-known mainstream voice in Darren Revelle, I honestly just can't anymore. Because think what you want about backyard breaks, and in all total honesty, they definitely aren't my cup of tea. However, the alleged controversy of them pulling three major hits out of three different Panini products and the ensuing social media investigation, complete with statistical extrapolation, I don't think it tells the whole story. See, the problem is keyboard warriors rarely, if ever, know the complete picture. And such was clearly the case with this latest hit job. Now, I'm not claiming to have all of the answers, but what I do know is that, number one, backyard breaks is likely the biggest volume breaker in the hobby, having exceeded Mojo and Layton, each have expressed this sentiment about Backyard. Number two, Backyard Breaks buys product from just about everyone they possibly can, and not just a single source. They simply purchase too much or break too much product. They can't possibly source it from one place. And three, because they're a breaker without a brick and mortar store, they cannot be a Panini Direct account. So the notion and allegation that they're getting loaded boxes or cases from Panini, in my opinion, is complete and total garbage, because they're not, because they can't. And that's all I'm going to say.
According to Deadline, Netflix has officially onboarded an untitled feature starring Adam Sandler with the Safdie brothers, writing, directing, and producing. While still in early development at the streamer, sources say the hope is to shoot the project in the second quarter of 2023. Netflix did not confirm any other details, but apparently several sources say it is likely set in the world of high-end card collecting. Adam Sandler, trading cards. Boom. Sandler and Safdies have been talking about a follow-up project for some time, given the success of Uncut Gems, which earned Sandler some of the best reviews of his career. We will share any additional details as we find them.
Yeah, that should be pretty cool.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, it's time for the Alton Insights Failed Flip of the Week. Well, it happened again. Tom Brady's Contenders ticket autos continue to be a tax loss generating machine. You might recall that 2 months ago, right here in the Alton Insights report, we noted that the Tom Brady championship ticket card number 91 of 100 sold for $1.2 million. And while still a hefty sum, just 6 months after, or prior to that rather, it had been purchased for $2,040,000. So, ouch. And here we go again. This time, it's number 8 of 100 and losing its now former owner somewhere in the neighborhood of $1 million. The card was purchased in June of 2021 at Leland's for $3,107,000. $100,372 and returned to the auction block last week at PWCC with a final sale price of $2.4 million with buyer's premium. Interestingly, that's actually the most expensive football card auction sale of 2022. But if you think about it, it's still a 23% loss before netting out buyer's premium and any fees. Ouch.
I still don't understand why people sell unless they really need the money. I still just do not get it. He's a goat. He's an icon. I know he's getting divorced and all that, but I mean, just don't sell. BCW Supplies is running a sweet little giveaway on Twitter, but it ends soon. Simply follow them on Twitter at BCW_sportscards and retweet the tweet with this image by 10 a.m. Eastern Time on Friday, October 28th, for a chance to win this Andre Dawson signed Topps clearly authentic card and a box of PCW 35-point magnets. Very cool, BCW.
Yeah, very cool. So check this out. Chris, Card Ladder has launched a very cool new feature, camera search. You can now search for millions of cards using your phone's camera, making it ideal if you're, you know, out at a show and you need to price a card quickly. Simply use Card Ladder to snap a pic and get accurate matches with full pricing history. Watch this.
We launched a new feature, and it's the ability to search cards using your camera. Go to the search page. There'll be a camera icon in the top right. Click that. Take a picture of a card. Use pictures from your camera roll, and you'll get a bunch of results.
It's a really powerful feature.
and you can search sales history, and you can also search cards in the ladder if you would like to get more in-depth research.
Just one more way to navigate the search.
And that sounds like a really cool thing. I mean, just to search the card on the camera, and just makes it very, very convenient. I really like that. Oh, absolutely. With a recent tweet, or I should say, with a we go a tease. You we said got. That to me. What was that?
we got.
We got a tease reveal about this year's Panini NBA Player of the Day National Sweepstakes winner, Justin, who's a local shop in Card Shack. Whose local shop is Card Shack, was selected the winner from among thousands of nationwide entries. Congrats, Justin, and we'll have more details soon.
Very cool. I love promotion. Well, plenty of books have been produced on the life and career of Mickey Mantle, but never before has one of the most avid fans and collectors chronicled the Hall of Famer's life through an extensive collection of authentic memorabilia. Sports Collectors Daily reports that author Stephen Lane has been collecting Mantle memorabilia for over 60 years. He not only owns the best collection of Mantle memorabilia around, he's also the author of the hardcover book that will be available this fall that shows it all off. Titled Mickey Mantle, A Life in Memorabilia, acts as a museum tour through Mantle's life. It includes items from Lane's extensive and valuable collection, as well as stories from Mantle's 18-year career. SC Daily notes that the book is priced at $30 and is available for pre-order now on themickeymantle.com. It's expected to be ready for shipping in late November or December, just in time for that Mantle fan Christmas list.
Mickey Mantle is one of my favorites. I have to check that one out. That sounds really, really cool. A recent article in Forbes examines an inside look into Upper Deck's strategy to combine digital and physical collectibles, including why the company passed on the initial NFT craze. Upper Deck President Jason Mascera discusses the company's revenue growth during the pandemic and how the company is pivoting to address the challenges the hobby is facing with consumers having less discretionary income. He also discusses how Upper Deck was able to maintain the NHL and NHLPA licenses and stay out of Fanatics drama. It is one of the more transparent interviews we've witnessed from Upper Deck. So be sure to check it out and the full article on Forbes.com.
BCW Supplies, as we mentioned, has been doing some massive giveaways, as we just talked about, and they've been doing giveaways with their weekly NFL Pick'em contest, which we had originally told you about as well. But now you can enter the BCW's Supplies pool in the 2022 FIFA World Cup Bracket Challenge for a chance to win soccer cards, as well as amazing BCW card accessories through each round of the tournament. For more details, please visit the BCW Supplies blog or check out their social media on Twitter at BCW Supplies.
While the sports card market correction continues, some blue chip collectibles continue to gain momentum. Case in point, this week a record sale price was achieved for the LeBron James exquisite RPA rookie card, selling through Golden for $2.4 million.
So LeBron up, Brady down. Interesting. Late breaking news this afternoon from the weekly Leaf Trading Cards live stream on Loop, CEO Brian Gray announced that Wander Franco has fulfilled all of his long outstanding redemptions and as a make good, every autograph has been signed on card.
Nice.
So you might have had to wait, but hey, you're getting an on card auto. Pretty cool. And that's a look at this week's hobby happenings.
Nice. Some positive news there to end hobby happenings. We had a lot of theft, but I think that's a sign of the times, or just some poor choices by people. And obviously the Bertrand name got slandered.
Yeah, it's not often you see the Bertrand name. So it's interesting when it does pop up, and I hated seeing it in that context.
Sure. Not a good headline.
All right. Well, let's dive into our live box break segment of the evening. And we're going to start things off with HRO Hero DC Unlock the Multiverse Chapter 2 with Black Adam. But ooh, before we get cracking, Chris, what do people need to do to be eligible to win prizes this evening?
It's very, very simple. I think people who are watching every week, you know what to do. But here we go. Go to the Go GTS Live Twitter account. And I just put a tweet out there for everyone to retweet. You have to retweet, but you also have to watch the show. And it does begin with get ready for some box breaks, because obviously Fire Hands is going to dig into these great boxes tonight. So again, just go to the Go GTS Live Twitter account and retweet. And again, you have to watch the show until the end, because that's when we will announce the winners of these great hits that we pulled this evening.
I had so much fun with the first iteration of this product. Excited to be able to check it out again.
Yeah.
And one of the things that we noted when we kind of gave a little tease preview on this previously, was that the manufacturer, which is US Playing Cards, which is part of the Card of Monday group, was very surprised at the explosive nature on the secondary market, and they felt like a lot of people got priced out of the product. And so, unlike some manufacturers who introduce a minimum advertised pricing policy, they've introduced a maximum. Interesting.
It's different. But this is a very cool product. Again, not only is it the physical, but there's also the digital aspect of these cards.
Correct. Every single card has a unique mint number and can be entered into the Hero app and generates a digital NFT twin.
And the lower the number means the more rare that it is.
Correct. Right. So like the mint number on this was A26114. And so the lower the number, not necessarily every card's a one of one, essentially. So the lower the mint, technically the more valuable it is.
Right. Because I did see on the secondary market where the last release, or I should say the debut release of this, the lower was obviously going for much more money.
Star Girl and Stripe. I actually kind of liked that TV show when I was watching TV.
Oh, there we go. Black Adam.
There he is. Comics.
The Rock plays Black Adam in the movie.
And then every card every pack of the 20, there's three different SKUs, 24 pack, 8 pack, and 4 pack. And there's a limited edition card in each pack. This one is of Cyclone from the Black Adam movie character.
And are we breaking the 24 or the 8 pack? I'm sorry?
We are breaking the 24.
The 24.
Oh, that's a nice Invisible card. Jet.
Yeah, that's cool.
Remember Super Friends on Saturday mornings? It was one of my favorite cartoons.
Really cool.
The Invisible Jet. Fortress of Solitude. So we have characters, objects, comics, locations. inks, so black and white.
Pretty cool.
Character art from Black Adam.
Yeah, just the illustrations are really cool in this. I like it.
Hierarchy power. Atom Smasher character. Superman and the Legion of Superheroes. Inks. So that's what it looks like before the colors applied. Iconic symbols. Nightwing. Locations. Lighthouse of Amnesty Bay. Green Arrow, one of my favorites. Cyclone. Black Adam character art. Justice Society.
It's neat. Oh, that's
Flashpoint,
cool.
Flashpoint Batman, Thomas Wayne.
That's neat.
Some odds. Commons, 40% insert rate. Uncommon, 26. Superior, 16.72. Epic, 13.5. Legendary 2.82, Mythic 0.04. What you need, I think it necessarily designates on the card. Show off this QR code.
Oh, Superman, nice.
Clarion. Batman versus the Mutant Leader. Justice League of America. Classic.
Yeah. It's a good one.
Hawkman. Cyclone. Supergirl.
That's cool. I'm digging the shiny. The shiny looks good.
Oh, yeah. The cheetah, iconic symbols. Black Manta. Vandal Savage. Trident of Poseidon. Object. Dr. Fate.
Bond.
Mm-hmm. The Team. And Superman versus Wrath.
That's cool.
Batman versus Robin. Red Hood.
Nice.
Nightwing, iconic symbol. Ragman. Cheetah. Black Adam. There he is.
That is the Rock.
Sure is.
Pretty sweet.
Birds of Prey. I'd like DC to remake that movie.
That'd be pretty cool.
First one was not all that great. Batgirl, aka Barbara Gordon. House of Mystery.
I don't want to go into that house. Yeah. No. The walls probably bleed.
Justice League Satellite. Lightning Strikes. Dr. Fate. Ever People. Raven. Arrow. Princess Diana of. I always screwed this up.
I believe that's Wonder Woman.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is. But nice. Her name is Princess Diana of Themis.
I remember because I actually did grading the stars of Wonder Woman.
Green Lantern, aka Hal Jordan. Character art, Hawkman. Justice League Dark. Oh, like that. Team up.
That's neat. Yeah.
That's cool.
That's
cool. Joker.
Yeah, that's neat.
Here it is again. James, can't remember how to pronounce where Wonder Woman's from.
I don't know either. Yeah. Themyscira?
That sounds about right.
That's what it looks like. Somebody in the chat, sound off, write it out for me.
Joker.
I think you got that, James.
I hope so. I said it confidently.
You did
say it confidently.
You said it with authority.
So yeah. I wasn't going to... I don't think that is correct, but I
don't either.
I do appreciate your confidence. Ooh,
that's
that
neat.
Lex Luthor.
Yeah, that's definitely a cool one. It's popping out at you.
It's one of those things that as soon as I hear it, I go, I know that.
Reamersma 63, them is Kira. Them is Kira.
Them is Kira?
Okay. Kira. Them is Kira.
Kira.
Them is Kira.
Kira.
Yeah.
Okay.
Superman Inc. Green
pronunciation
Arrow
start early tonight.
Yeah.
Black Adam and the Justice Society. Adam Smasher.
Cool. Oh, that's neat.
And Ill Edition Hawk. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to break half this box, and I really want to get the packs into a couple of viewers' hands. So we're going to give six packs to two winners, Chris.
Six packs to two. Wow, nice.
Here we go. One more from Opa Klingon Style in the chat. The Mascara. The Mascara.
The Mascara. Okay.
I don't think that's right either.
We're going to throw a bunch of different ones out there.
Justice League of America, Inc. Power Battery. I could be wrong. Ooh, comic panel. Page 5 of JLA Justice number 9. That's cool. Pretty cool. 2007.
Wow. I just like the foil. The foil, they make the illustration just pop out at you. It's really neat. Oh, that's a cool one.
It's beyond classic.
Yep.
It's one of my favorite. So it's comic way back 1963.
Wow, that's cool.
Death in a Family. Martian Manhunter. One.
All right.
Yeah. Cyclone. Strikes. Batman Earth 52.
That's neat.
One, two, three, six. Two, three, four. Six. See, I was having so much fun, I would have just kept opening and opening. Now, however, they did send an 8-pack.
Okay.
Is it an 8-pack? No, a 4-pack. And I think what you get from
is this like a blaster box or something? Or?
It's there's also an 8-pack. I'd say the 8-pack is closer to the blaster. This is just an even more friendly price point. Contains 20 DC unlocked and 9 Black Adam limited edition cards. So specific to the SKU, let's say you are really just going after the movie cards for Black Adam. These are going to be guaranteed. So here, I'll just be easier to show you.
Just a really cool product, though.
Yeah.
They do a really nice job with this.
So whoever wins it, be sure you download the HRO app and score your NFT twins for each
right.
card.
Yeah. There it is again. Nice.
Showcase the Joker.
Yeah.
Head to toe.
Oh, the rock right in front.
Dr. Fate, Rail Edition off the bat.
Neat.
So I think unlike the 24 pack where the foil could be just from the universe, I think every foil is going to be from the movies.
Okay. So it's more themed than this?
Yeah. Detective Comics, nice. 1970.
Oh, that's cool.
No, but it's not Black Adam. So the foils are the same, but I guess you're guaranteed one foil movie card. I thought the solicitation was a little confusing.
So this is a 4-pack premium?
Yes.
Okay.
Crime so this... Alley. We all know what happened in Crime Alley.
So it says you get at least 5 holographic cards, guaranteed.
So one pack should have 2?
Seems that way. It says including a limited edition card featuring movie poster artwork, Warner Brothers and DC's Black Adam. So you should get probably 1 limited edition card, movie poster artwork, and then four holographic cards. So
Shazam. I really enjoyed that movie. It was good. Blue Beetle. Cyclone from the movie. Panel 6. Grodd from page 5 of JLA Justice number 9, 2007. Odds remain the same through each skew, it looks like.
Okay. Yeah, so it says 3 packs of 7 cards, which include 5 base cards and 2 limited edition cards. And you get 1 premium pack of 8 cards, including the premium movie card.
This must be the 8-pack Atom Smasher.
There it is again. That's a cool card. And there you go.
Oh, nice. There you go. Cool.
Nice.
All right. So that's a look at HRO DC Unlock the Multiverse Chapter 2, Black Adam. And again, we want to have you to have as much fun as I did opening packs of this. So 2 winners are going to get 6 packs each for their enjoyment.
Nice.
All right. And then a trifecta of Panini products.
So a little mini Panini Palooza?
Mini Panini Palooza. Yeah. I like it. First up, select draft picks football. 3 autographs in every box. 3 packs, 15 cards. So an auto in every pack.
Yeah. Yep, you get the 3 autos, you get the 3 silver prism parallels, 6 inserts, and 6 parallels. Always a cool product. You get 2 base tiers. You got concourse and field level in this one. So it's not 3. Let's get the 2. Then you can also get the zebra. That's good.
There's zebras in here?
There's zebras. We're chasing all right. Some zebras. Then, of course, the color wheel, which is a pretty cool card, too.
All right. So the thing about draft picks is you're going to have veterans and rookies in their college uniforms, like Ezekiel Elliott from Ohio State, Chris Olave from Ohio State, rookie. Donovan McNabb.
Nice.
Jake Ferguson, rookie. Kyle Pitts. Justin Herbert.
Ooh, there we go. First, although.
Tyler Goodson. Tyler Goodson. Is that Iowa Hawkeyes? Yeah, I think so. Malik Willis, red, numbered to 149.
Oh, that's cool, Aaron Rodgers. Yeah, that's nice. Field level, too. Nice.
Aaron Rodgers, hyper.
That's a cool one.
Cal. Silver, Jameis Winston, State. Numbers insert, Matt Corral. Corral.
There you go.
Another silver. This one of Patrick Mahomes, Texas Tech. Rondé Barber.
Yeah.
Terry Bradshaw. And Drake London.
Very cool. Very sharp cards. I'm a big fan of the select. Really cool. You can have a lot of fun with these cards, too. I mean, if you have a buddy or someone that you know that is a big football fan, you can test their knowledge on what school a lot of these guys went to. Like, Rob, you just opened up that pack. What school did Donovan McNabb go to?
I'm going to say Syracuse.
Good job. Nice.
Based on that uniform.
Yeah.
Kyle Hamilton, rookie. Matt Ryan. DeAndre Swift. Jonathan Taylor. Jerry Rice. Carson Strong.
There you go.
Julio Jones to 199.
It's a cool one.
Alabama Crimson Tide.
Wow, this next one.
Drew Bledsoe, hyper.
Yeah.
Silver, Devin White.
Oh, that's cool.
Who knows, Auburn.
Yeah. Neat. Ooh, got a gold.
Kenny Walker the third, number to just 20.
That's a good one.
Currently the leader
of
25.
Yeah, currently leader for offensive rookie of the year.
I think he had like 160 yards and 2 touchdowns this past week.
Yeah, that's a big one.
Is that a sneaky hit?
Yeah. That's definitely a sneaky one. Yeah.
Or is that not sneaky?
Yeah, you know what though? That has the potential to be a boom.
Okay.
It really does. The way that he's playing right now, James hit it on the head. He's playing really, really well.
Bob Gronkowski and second auto, Jalen Wittermeyer, silver. Is the other one a silver? It's not a silver.
Oh, very good.
Wait, those aren't? They don't say Prism?
Isn't that weird?
That's wild. They're really shiny.
Oh, wait. There it is. Right there.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. There it is. Huh.
I was looking for it at the top, too, James.
Right? Yeah.
They switched it up on
where it belongs.
Jason Witten, Tennessee. Desmond Ridder. Sean Alexander. TJ Watt. Eli Manning. Hey,
there we go.
Zeke.
Of Ezekiel Elliott.
That's cool. Oh, and a tie-dye.
Wow.
Whoa. Devontae Adams tie-dye.
Yeah. Oh,
nice.
Back-to-back zebra and tie-dye?
And wow, another 25. One numbered 1 of 25. The other one was numbered 1 of 25 as well. That's interesting.
Wow. That's awesome. Another Kenny Walker. It's like a also hot pack.
Numbered to 149.
You got a bow. Whoa.
Bow silver. Sparks. Reese Hall.
Nice.
Sparks insert. This one. Tyler Van Dyke.
That's cool.
Love me some Barry Sanders.
Yeah, that's awesome.
David Ajabo. Miles Garrett. And.
Ooh!
Whoa!
There you go.
Boom!
That's a good one.
Explosion. Kenny Pickett.
Wow. Nice. Not numbered, though, right? Nice card, though.
Okay.
That was a great pack.
Solid box all around. All right.
Jeez.
So what I'm going to do is Kenny Pickett stands alone. Let's see. How about both Kenny Walkers?
Okay.
And two random cards from the Devontae Adams, Ezekiel Elliott, Julio Jones, and Malik Willis. I'll throw in with one of those other autographs. So you can just say Jalen Wintermeyer and color and Tyler Goodson and color. So four winners altogether. Does that sound good?
Uh-huh. Yeah, that sounds fine.
Those are all decent. Four nice prize packs there.
Who was the other auto? Goodson? What was his first name?
Tyler.
Tyler Goodson.
Nice box.
Yeah, great box. That was just
that one pack.
Yeah.
Kenny Pickett auto. Okay, from the NCAA to the NFL with NFL Black.
Nice. Get one rookie patch autograph, one additional autograph card, one memorabilia card, one parallel card, and one base card in every box.
Put the knife away. Cutter.
Watch yourself, Rob. There we go. Nice big pack. These cards are awesome just because of the all black.
Oh, you know what I skipped?
What's that?
I realized, James, why didn't you correct me?
What?
Between Hobby Happenings and this, I was going to play the interview.
Oh, yeah. I forgot to.
We'll play it right after this. Does that work for you?
Yeah.
Okay. I feel like I forgot something. Cordero Patterson.
Yeah, he's out for the year. He has an ACL. Yeah, really nice card. Oh, okay. Something here.
Number to 99. Jersey material.
Okay.
Of rookie influx memorabilia, Sky Moore.
Yeah, he's got a great name. Yeah. Good player.
A parallel of Mike Gesicki. the 76. It's funky.
That's cool, yeah. Yeah.
Really cool.
Something coming here from Derek Stingley Jr. And it is an auto numbered to 199.
That's a good one. Even though he plays defense, I know a lot of people don't like defense, but he was a number three pick in the draft, so that's a great one.
Garrett Wilson, dual jersey auto numbered to 99.
That's a good one. Yeah.
Very nice. Black. I like it. Great looking cards.
Yeah.
Nice matte texture to them, too. All right. Three winners. And with that, so the Sky Moore jersey, I'm going to pair up with the Gasecki parallel. Derek Stingley Jr. solo and the dual memorabilia auto of Garrett Wilson. So three winners. Right. Next up, from the gridiron to the hardwood. Did you get all those, Chris? You good?
I got all those. We're all good. Yep, all good. Three autograph cards, or I should say three autographs or memorabilia cards in the box, and then 12 prisms.
Select NBA.
Yeah, the checklist was just made available today, so it's up on our website.
Which is?
GoGTS.net.
There you go, baby.
Nice little shuffle.
You got to shuffle.
Sure. Got to make it interesting. Dealer.
Jalen Brown. Gary Trent Jr.
Ooh, already right something.
The back here.
Yeah.
Oblie green auto numbered to 99.
Wow.
Boom.
That is a boom.
Wow. Watch
the boom, boom. Shake the room. That's a good one.
Nice.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Davion Mitchell.
That's James.
Spilo. Yeah.
Premier level, even.
Cool.
That's good. Yeah. First pack, Evan Mobley. Like it was nothing. Yeah.
That's why you got to shuffle.
Exactly.
Jason Tate. Derek Rose. Cade Cunningham, rookie. Some die cut love of Jason Tatum.
I'm sorry, blue. Cade Cunningham. Nice.
Yeah, Cade Cunningham, love rookie. It. Yeah. And then Jason Tatum.
That's a good one. Yeah. Die-cut. You go wrong with a Tatum.
Isaiah Jackson. Delano Banton, rookie. Rajon Rondo.
Another James boy.
Cool.
Anthony Edwards. That's Concourse. Sorry, Jim. Alfred Payton Silver.
Okay.
Zion.
That's nice. Yeah.
See,
he's back. Yeah.
Back in form yet?
Yeah. I know he had like a little hip pointer the other night.
Sitting out, I think. Do they play tonight? Either tonight or tomorrow. But he's back. He's back.
Yeah. Looks good. Good shape.
Photo variations. It's cool. Let's see if there's a. So that's concourse. Let me go back to this other one. Yep. Courtside.
Yeah, they got the concourse premium level and the courtside.
Ja Silver?
That's a good one. Nice. He's doing really well. Yeah.
Anthony Davis. We saw one of him too, so yep. It's a courtside.
This is going to be fascinating to follow Ja and Zion through their career, see which one's going to be better.
Yeah, right?
Oh, it's going to be pretty interesting.
Gdonchik. Jean.
There we go. Well,
Russell Westbrook player. Action. Yeah. Excuse me. Two. Io. DeSumno.
A lot of people like him, too. He had a pretty good rookie year last year.
It's a premier level.
Yeah, I think he made the third team.
Yeah. I believe it was the third
team.
Yeah,
I think so.
Nice, Jalen
he's
Green.
Doing well. He's playing really, really well.
Isaiah Todd, rookie.
Okay.
There. What do we got here? What do we got back. Here? Raymond Felton, jersey. Shiny. Prism. Mias Quita. The fun prism. Not numbered. Fun.
Very cool.
Keon Johnson, rookie. Jimmy Butler. Isaiah Jackson.
Cool. Garza. Yeah. He's not a bad player.
He's with
had
the
a great
Wolves
college
now.
Career. Is he with the Wolves?
Well, he's with their G League team. But okay. He's on the roster, yeah. He got one of the 50.
Two-way contracts.
Man. Yeah. I'm a fan. Played well in the preseason.
Yeah, really great college player. Yeah. Really underrated player.
Blah. Skipped over that Jam Premier League. Kevin Durant, Joe Harris, Bones Highland.
Yeah. People like Bones.
I'm a fan. He's fun. Although I drafted him in fantasy and I dropped him.
Did you?
For Trey Murphy, so.
Okay. Okay.
I mean, he was a good pickup.
Sure.
But I do like him.
Depot, Quentin Grimes. Kai Jones, jersey auto, rookie, silver, number to 199, Kai Jones. Here's a silver, Joe Wieskamp, rookie. Rubio.
He's still hanging around, Ricky Rubio.
Yeah, he's great.
Darius Garland. Kyle Kuzma. Jalen Suggs, rookie.
Okay.
Silver. Jrue Holiday. Jeremiah Robinson Earl. Corey Kispert, Jordan Clarkson. Okay. 75 years of the NBA. Oh, cool. Jalen Suggs. That is cool.
Neat. Yeah.
So shiny.
Well, little die cut action.
I was going to say, who's that behind him?
Ooh.
Yeah. Huh. Nice little one.
That's a boom.
Cade Cunningham.
Yeah.
Die cut action number to 99.
That is a boom.
Premier level. Boom.
Yeah, that's a good one.
35 of 99. What was the number?
65.
Yeah, wow. What a box.
Yeah.
Last pack. Chris Paul. Alex Caruso. Jonathan Kuminga. 75 years of the NBA. Finished on the rookie power rankings either in 10th or 12th spot. Kyle Lowry. And Peyton Richard.
Nice.
Let's go back through here and see what we got. Obviously.
That's a very nice box.
Yes. The Evan Mobley stands alone.
Yeah, that Evan Mobley was fantastic.
Cade Cunningham die cut. And his base rookie.
Is that together? The two
yes.
Cunninghams? Okay.
Got memorabilia auto. What's that other? So. Two, three. 12. All right, so it'll be the Kai Jones and the Raymond Felton and an assortment of color. There's 13 cards. 7 cards will go with Felton and 6 cards will go Jones.
They want they're begging for the Mobley to get cased.
Begging for the Mobley. Begging.
Mm-hmm.
What do you want that? You want
it is
that,
a pretty it is
you want
a
that
pretty
magnetic?
Yeah.
Do you want that top loaded?
Ooh. Let's see if they come
it is a good. It is a good card though. It is a really nice one.
Penny sleeve top load.
Penny sleeve top load. All right. You want gold foil rookie top loader, plain top loader?
Gold foil rookie.
Getting fancy over there, Rob.
A gold foil rookie.
I think I can make that happen. Might have to get out of my chair to do it. But I can do it.
That's not as big as the Scotty Barnes that we pulled, but still a really nice card of Evan Mobley.
Yeah. Oh, we did get up. He left his chair. There he is.
Did he leave his chair?
He did. He's back.
Rob, you were wandering?
Yeah, I had to go get the...
There you go. Look at that. It's all fancy now. It's with the rookie card one. That's official. Nice.
Might as well do the Cades while I'm here.
Yeah, we're here. I like it.
Not getting up again. So it's,
it's only
time.
One time. It's only one trip.
I need a 55 point. Yep.
Nice. That's a beaut.
Yeah. Very nice.
Yeah.
Right.
Did well.
That is going to do it for our box break segment for this evening. Thank you to Daniel Carrier at US Playing Cards and Card Monday, and to Scotty Prusha at Panini America. All right. I did have this, as I mentioned, broken up differently. So what we are going to do, let's see. We're going to go
soccer, BCW, Trout, Hot in the Shop.
Got to slip the poll question in there. Oh, let's do soccer cards United, and then just two camera. So yeah, soccer cards United, PSA surprise for Mike Trout, poll question, and vendor spotlight with BCW. So we got back-to-back videos for you guys to check out. We'll be back in about 10 minutes, but watch this interview, part one of two, with Soccer Cards United, where we talk about the hobby across the pond, and touch on the NFL, F1, card shows. These guys are really insightful, and they're really nice guys. We had an opportunity to meet them at the National. Check this out, and we'll be right back. Wow, that is fancy. Hey, I am pleased to be joined on the hot seat with the boys from Soccer Cards United, across the pond, as we say here in America. Technology is amazing. Welcome Enzo and Jason. Enzo's in the top right. In fact, I think I have the capability of, show display names. That should be on. But anyway, and then in the Phillies hat, yep. Jason. So obviously a little bit of a baseball fan, huh?
We spent a couple of days in Philly after the National in Atlantic City this year. We got out of AC and went to Philly for a couple of days. And I have kind of a little collection of fitted baseball caps. So the Phillies had to go in the collection.
All right. There you go. Well, Soccer Cards United, seem to be all over social media and have developed a very popular following over there. But for our American audience that may not know and be familiar with Soccer Cards United, what is that? Are you guys breakers? Are you a podcast? Are you just two dudes that like cards? All the above? What's up?
So we are, we started as a podcast. We started our podcast back in July 2020. And basically why we started our podcast was Enzo got into soccer card collecting, and we are both running a different soccer show before then. And then through Enzo, I got into soccer collecting. And what we realized was there was a kind of a confluence there. The people that were used to collecting cards in the States, they weren't so sure on how the sport worked. And the people that already liked the sport weren't so sure how the cards worked. And we said at the intersection of those two things, there's definitely a podcast. Initially, I was skeptical. I agreed to 10 episodes, and we haven't stopped since. Since then, we've also launched a website where we sell sealed boxes. So we do a little bit of podcasting, a little bit of online retail, a little bit of YouTube, and everything in between.
Nice. Now, Enzo, I know that being the director of marketing for GTS and helping coordinate some overseas sponsorship of card shows that we're involved in, it seems that there's a pretty regular circuit in multiple countries for card shows. You mentioned before we went live that you guys just got back from the Paris card show. First, tell me about that experience. What was that like? What do the French think about trading cards as opposed to stickers? And what did you see at the show? Any takeaways?
You know, it's been interesting. So this kind of circuit has kind of only come in the last 12 months. Prior to that, you wouldn't really get anything. We've been to London 4 times. We went to Denmark recently, and this was the first Paris card show. It was interesting. We learned a lot about the European hobby, that kind of corner of Europe. Huge basketball collectors there. They've been the NBA is huge in France, bigger in terms of like collecting, bigger collector base of basketball fans than there is even of soccer. at that moment.
Interesting.
At this moment in time. Yeah, like there's more soccer fans, but in terms of collecting, there's more baseball, basketball collectors, and they've been doing that since the early 90s. Like we've seen a lot of early 90s cards when we were there going around. But yeah, there's a huge appetite. It's growing. You know, we noticed that there was no like hobby shop over there either. The hobbyists, like we are a hobby shop. There was a German one, there was an Italian one, David Adams as well. They have a European setup. They were over, but there was no French hobby shop. So it's still very much early there, especially compared to London. In a similar situation to Denmark, but in general, yeah, it's the kind of difference in France is the huge basketball followership there.
Yeah, that makes sense because they've had, you know, some key players in the NBA. I mean, Tony Parker comes to mind immediately, you know, as being a native of France and having been on championship teams and excelling the way he did. And all sorts of players seem to come out of France. So that makes sense to me. Hearing that there's more basketball card collectors than soccer collectors right now in France. That's interesting because I think one of the things that we're all navigating as we, you know, understand the hobby and the market over there is where are the sweet spots with particular sports. And one of the things I wanted to ask you guys about, the NFL is obviously making a huge push into Europe. They've got, you know, a game in Germany coming up. They're always playing a game in the UK, it seems. And I was reading a newsletter from Front Office Sports talking about the number of people attending those games. Now, one of the things that we're not seeing is fans turning into collectors in football. Do you guys have any reasons why that might be on your end?
So, I mean, the first thing that springs to mind is that most of those people that are getting into the NFL in Europe will at some point in their lives have maybe been soccer fans or at least grown up in a soccer fan kind of culture. And soccer is very different to American sports in that it's not commercialized as kind of as a starting point, you know. Football clubs, like we never would refer to a football club as a franchise. The idea of merchandise and all that comes after the idea of the club being a local community team, which you kind of play for you know, for pride and to represent the local community. Exactly. So collecting is not something that springs to mind immediately if you're a soccer fan. And then if you go into other sports like NFL or basketball, I mean, one of the reasons why in France say they're into basketball cards is because they had to kind of get into American basketball culture in order to fully have their basketball fandom. And therefore, they're going to interact with a basketball card. So in the NFL, I think it might be a long time, maybe longer than the NFL, maybe longer than Panini are hoping, before you see enough fans that conversion funnel will eventually produce collectors, you know? But like, it's already kind of an alien idea, so it's going to take time.
They've been talking about, I mean, Roger Goodell really wants a team over there. He really wants a team over there. So what do you think would be the best country for a team? And if they get a team, does that community crossover then immediately begin to happen as far as a general interest then in merchandising, collectibles, et cetera?
I mean, the place that springs to mind for me would be London. Simply as a start point, because it's a massive city. You know, you have 8 million people or whatever it is in London. You're in the UK and you're well connected to the rest of Britain and the rest of Europe as well by sea and by air. And you have English, you know, an English speaking market immediately. And as soon as you put a team in place, you put a franchise in place, then people can actually connect with a franchise without having to look around. You have to pick one. There already is one in London. That's when you get stuff like you can inherit a franchise from your family, from your parents or your grandparents or whatever. You know, I'm from this place and all my family support the team from this place, and so now do I. I mean, it's a good idea. Whether or not I will take, I don't know, it could be a risk.
Interesting. Now, Enzo, let's shift gears from the NFL and talk a little F1. I've been an F1 fan all my life, basically. I mean, when I saw Ayrton Senna drive when I was a kid, I was just like, wow. And The popularity of that sport in even more ways than soccer, I think, crosses so many cultures, so many countries. I mean, it's popular in Asia, America, South America, Europe, even Africa. I mean, so when Top secured the Formula One license, what was the overall reaction from that you could gauge from the racing community, and how have you seen it transcend into active collecting?
Yeah, so at the very start, it was everyone didn't really know what to do with it, mainly because a lot of the F1 people who F1 fans by their nature are collectible. It's one of the most collectible sports. Every F1 fan will have a small miniature helmet or whatever. It's a very collectible and high end as well kind of fandom. But a lot of them it brought in a lot of collectors, essentially. It brought a lot of people into sports cards that had never been into sports card, and it brought a lot of people into the sport because of the success of the 2020 Chrome. But at the start, I was hearing stories of people turning away Formula One Dynasty boxes. They didn't really want to buy them. It took a while for it to really hit it. I think after the National, it really took heat when people seen how much demand there was for it. But yeah, similar to soccer, it's a global sport. And dissimilar to soccer, it was much easier to really take the US by storm. And I think part of that is because it's easier to understand. There's 20 drivers, there's 10 teams, they all play. It's similar to the way you have one league, the MLB, the NBA. It's much more easier to kind of get a grasp of. Of course, the cultural impact of the likes of Drive to Survive, and just kind of having a ground zero. There wasn't too much confusion from a collecting point of view. There was Top Chrome, there was Sapphire, there was Dynasty. And then the following year you had Flagship, you had a few other products. But it's been incredible to see, and we're seeing, I think, the US Grand Prix just this weekend gone broke the record for the highest attendance of any Formula One event in history. So
in it couldn't history.
Be doing much better. Yeah, crazy, crazy.
Yeah, it's really been an amazing ride, and I really have to hand it to you got to tip your cap, like you said, to Drive to Survive, the Netflix series. I think brought in so many fans because there really is so much drama behind the scenes that you may not have been aware of. And I'm sure, like hundreds of collectors, you're kicking yourself for not stashing a case of F1 Chrome away.
listen, who said we haven't? We might have. We have a few here. I have a few around me. I can't turn the camera, but there's no shortage of 2020 here.
Don't give them your address.
Yeah, I told my wife, I said, looking at our 401k lately, all we had to do was stash a couple of cases of this and we would have made up for it in the long run. Oh, kicking myself, guys, kicking myself. Want to go back to the conversation a little bit about card shows, because you guys got back from Paris. I know you were originally going to go to the UK card show. Did you guys end up going or no?
Yeah, we're going this weekend, yeah.
You'll go to the London show, and then after that, there's a show in Munich. Is that something you guys will be at too?
We'll be there as well, yeah.
We're getting our frequent flyer miles.
I was going to say, you guys are everywhere. So how important are shows for the growth of the hobby over there, given the lack of shops right now?
Huge.
Very, very important for a couple of reasons. One, obviously, if we go to a show and the same as other shops that may go, we bring sealed wax. And because people are kind of unsure about the hobby, there's people always have questions about shipping. They have questions about import tax. They have questions about buying from other countries. So if you turn up in somebody's city and you just have sealed wax and they can just pay you in cash, and it's just like they feel it's a much more simple interaction. Then the other thing we were talking about with some people over in France and in Copenhagen was that a show can kind of leave you with a target in mind. So let's say you don't want to open a hobby box, because if I open a hobby box and I collect, say it's a Serie A hobby box, I collect Napoli cards. So I get all my Napoli cards, but I hit a really nice Juventus card. If there's no show in my area in the next few months, I have to list that on eBay. I have to worry about posting it, maybe insuring it if it's a super valuable card, all that stuff. Whereas if I'm thinking, okay, it's February, I know there's going to be a show in April, that's maybe an hour or 2 hours away on the train. I can jump on the train, head there. Somebody will buy it off me there. you know, it provides like almost like a place for these cards to go and a bit of exit liquidity for people, which encourages them to go back liquidity. In. Yeah.
No, especially
I love that term.
Especially for in the US, you could open a box and, you know, you can list it on eBay and you're just paying domestic shipping and someone will buy it. If you're in France and you hit a card an Italian person wants, the shipping is going to be more expensive because you're going to a different country. And so that's it. It just brings you together. And instead of opening a box and what you hit, you kind of, not that you're stuck with it, but like it's kind of an awkward thing to do, but you can go to a card show and it's essentially legal tender. Like we often will trade wax for cards. Like we would trade wax for cards and people are like, this is a card that's worth 200, but I didn't really want to go through all the hassle of selling it and the fees and the shipping. I'll give it to these guys. We know we're going to a show next week anyway. You get a box of wax to open with your friends or whatever and stuff like that. So, and they're just communal as well. A lot of people set up as just exhibitors at these card shows. We've seen that in France, just showing off their collection and just talking to the people that have spent the last 2 years just talking to on the internet during COVID, putting faces to names. And
peer-to-peer connections are really exactly. Sound really, really it's, important.
Yeah. It's a hobby after all, you know, it's, yes. it's hard to be a hobby if it's just Twitter and you're by yourself with your cards. But when someone's looking at your PSA 10 Ronaldo and they're just amazed and you kind of feel good about it. And, you know, you're making different moves. It's really, really enjoyable from a social point of view as well.
I hope you guys enjoyed that as much as I enjoyed talking with them. We'll show part two. It's time to preview Cup. But updating the poll question, which was, do you submit cards for grading? And while we had a big jump in the number of people weighing in, the percentages stayed about the same. No, 63.5%. Yes, 36.5%. But a recent comment that I am just now seeing from Matthew Balsley, who won probably one of the greatest hits we ever pulled on this show, a Steph Curry auto redemption on card numbered to 25. It's been redeemed and he's got it in hand and showed it off for Go GTS PC. He said he should get that graded. Now, brings up an interesting topic because I've often felt, Chris, like, let's start with a 101.
Okay.
I feel if you grade a 101 and it turns out anything less than a 10, you've probably hurt the value a little bit because people are going to appreciate that it's a 101. Right. They're going to despise the fact that it's not in a 10 holder. So you run a risk doing that. At what point do you say that rule of thumb might apply? Does it apply up to 25 or is 25 safe?
It's an interesting question. It really is. I think, for instance, I'll do an example for you. I know that the Mike Trout 2009 Bowman Chrome autograph superfractor, one of one, was graded by Beckett and obviously it made a huge sale. And that's not a 10. I believe that was either a 9 or 8.5. I forget what the grade was on it, but I think it really depends on one, the player, the brand, and is it autographed or not. But if it's a one of one and it's of an iconic player and it's of a desired brand, to me personally, unless it's like under an 8, I would still have interest in it at some level. If I was someone who wanted to invest in it, obviously. Well, it provides better protection. Touch. Yeah, I think it depends on what you're looking to do with it. Are you looking to grade it, hold it, and then flip it? Or are you looking to grade it, hold it forever for your collection? With the end goal, maybe either selling it down the road or something. Or I think it really depends on what you're looking to do with it. But if you're looking to just have it as a one of one and get it graded, and it's your card, I think it really doesn't matter. But if you're looking to sell it or to buy it, to me, anything under an 8, I probably want to go for. But an 8 and above, I would probably be interested in.
Yeah, it's definitely worth contemplating before just making a snap decision on, sure. Oh, I got to get this graded. Because number one, if it is a matter of protection, hey, a diamond cut corner one touch will do the same, serve the agreed. Same purpose.
Sure.
If, and I have seen card sales where, you know, oh, it's a one-on-one, I've got to get it graded. And it doesn't come back what the person was expecting. And I think you've immediately devalued it. So you run the risk of then damaging the card when you grade it, crack it out of the slab that you didn't get the grade on it that you were hoping. So I think pre-grading, especially with some of the tools that are available now where you use the camera tech. I can't remember. And is it? Is it drip?
I think it was drip.
Yeah. I mean, pre-grading, I think, becomes really, really important.
It does.
In that question.
I think you can also use your eyeballs, too. If you get a one of one, just use your eyeballs and just see if the corners look okay or if it's centered or if there's some surface damage. But again, I really do think it comes down to the card, the player, or the entertainer, whoever it may be. And then you make your decision on getting it graded. But I don't know. I mean, for instance, I don't buy many packs, so I've never pulled a one-of-one. And I told you guys that on the show here. But if I pulled a one-of-one and it was of significance, I would probably look to get it graded just because, depending on who it was and what it was, that's all.
Yep, I can see that. I can see that. Don't know if you will be able to see this.
You got a one of one there?
No, I don't have a one of one, but if you are going to self-grade, and I highly recommend a loop with at least 20 times magnification, and ideally one that also has a UV light on it, because the UV light will pick up surface better than just a loop. And so, I mean, these are you want to use the same tools, if at all possible, that a grader is going to use when it comes to self-examining your cards. I don't think eyeballing it is enough when it comes to making a decision of that magnitude. Do I grade a 101 or a number to five or something sure. like that? So to each their own, right? But
just do you clean your card? Do you clean your cards at all? Do you clean them? Do you get like a nice microfiber cloth and
yeah,
clean?
I've got one of those. I definitely, you know, clean them up. I doctor them, you know.
Sure.
I don't talk to them.
You trim them. You do the little nice little magic there.
I rebuild the corners with paper mache. Yeah,
if you have the hands for it and the pristine cut ability, that's awesome. But
there's nothing
I personally
wrong with cleaning. Cleaning is not.
No, I clean my cards. So my process is, if I get a nice card, I will clean it very nicely and gently. I will look at it under light. I will do it at all different types of angles, but you can eyeball the centering. You can easily do the centering with your eyeballs. And to me, that's the most important subgrade that you can get, is the centering. That's my opinion on that grade. And also the magnifying glass, it looks like that Rob has there. It also does help.
This is a loop. It's got two different types of magnification, 30 and 60. And the battery is unfortunately dead, but it's got this one is awesome because it has a light and a UV black light. So
okay, that's good. The black
this is nice. Definitely yeah. some, you know, a handy tool if you are submitting on a regular basis, or even, you know, an occasional. Or if you're like Balsley, making a decision to do that. to submit that awesome Steph Curry on card auto number.
Now, I would say this too. He got that directly from Panini, correct?
Correct.
And that was likely shipped to him in a sealed top loader,
I would think.
So, in my opinion, when you get stuff directly from the manufacturer like that, now I've seen some cases where they may have a little bit of a corner or something like that. A lot of times they look really, really nice. Now, depending on, I haven't seen the card, but if he were to inspect it, I would imagine the card looks pretty good because it hasn't gone through the manufacturing process like a lot of the cards that you get in the packs. And Rob, you've seen videos of how they manufacture cards in those facilities where it's almost amazing. And you said this to me before, it's almost crazy how anything comes out at 10 out of packs sometimes. Just how they're just going through those conveyor belts and things of that nature, how they're getting packaged. You know, there's a lot of slamming going on there. So,
When they take the autos and they load them into this feeder.
Right.
And they turn a dial that says, you know, 1 in 10, 1 in, you know, whatever little insertion ratio.
Sure.
That is decided. And they're just going.
Yeah.
And it's, I'm like, whoa.
Yeah.
And then they get spit out and into the pack. And then, I mean, like I said, yeah, you summed it up exactly. I can't believe anything ever comes out of 10 from a
pack. So if M. Balsley has that card, that Steph Curry card, and that's coming directly from Panini in a top loader with a seal on it, I can't guarantee it, but I would almost say 9 times out of 10, you got a pretty nicely gradable card on your hands right there, I would say.
Cool. All right. I love the conversation. All right. What are we doing next? I got an idea. How about one more giveaway tonight?
Ooh, okay.
BCW has been, I want to make sure I can see myself for this one. BCW has been rolling out a series of interlocking card frames. We've seen one touches and top loaders in the past. But now you understand the part of the reason for tonight's poll question. Now they've come out with interlocking card frames for graded cards. And one of the great things about this is this fits any size slab because of the unique technology of being able to use various thicknesses. And so as you can see, it makes for really nice display presentation. And we've shown these in other formats. Just kind of wanted to.
Yeah, those are really sweet. Really cool. Especially looking to display your collection. Always a nice item to have. Rob is going to do some handy tool work here.
First, you got to grab yourself a couple graded cards.
Sure. He's like Tim the Toolman Taylor right now. He's going to go grab, you know, maybe a little screwdriver.
Save and directions.
There you go. Yeah. Don't want to hurt yourself on that.
No, nobody's going to hurt themselves.
No. Very little assembly required, I would imagine.
Yeah, all it is really is this... a backing plate, if you will.
So if you're like me, I'm not the most handy person in the world, but
I'm not the most handy person in the world either, but I think I can manage this.
That's good.
So I've got this one. This one.
I wonder what the percentage of people, we're talking about graded cards, you know, asking people if they get cards graded. Now, I wonder, do people get cards graded primarily for resale or do they get them graded for a collection too?
Good question. And all you need is something resembling a headed driver or pocket knife.
I've done it for both, though. I've done it for resale and collection.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely have cards that, you know, graded cards in my collection, which you will see here shortly.
Sure. Yeah, I have a bunch of graded. I have a bunch of graded cards. I mean, I have a ton of graded cards. I'd say probably about 60%.
Your slabs.
Yeah, I like my slabs. I mean, but I'm with a lot of the other people who do it for protection, but it also looks nice too. I mean, now I have cards that are slab that I don't agree with the grades of. I just haven't, you know, because we talk about grading and it's, you're really at the hand and the mercy of an individual grader or two people observing it.
How nice is that?
Oh, I got the Frank Thomas over there. That's a nice Frank Thomas card. Don't leave.
I bet you don't have the Nelly Fox though.
I don't have the Nelly Fox. I have the Thomas. I have a 10. Is it? What's your grade on the Thomas?
A 9.
I got a 10. I got a few 10s. I got a few 9s. It's a great card.
One of the things that's awesome, I think, about vintage cards is, I mean, that's only a 2.
But still, it's awesome.
That still looks.
Yeah. It's still classic. Awesome. Yeah. Yeah. So, I have a, like, my favorite.
I mean, these are in here. You know, you don't have to worry about them going anywhere. And no. Then they can be turned both ways and they've got hanging holes.
That's awesome.
Okay. So we're going to give. They were nice enough to send 2 packages of these. I'm going to save 1 for our Christmas spectacular. To put this into something, but we'll give 1 of these away this evening.
Great.
All right.
It's a great item.
Yeah. Very cool.
I guess the one thing I never understood, we're talking again about graded cards, and you may know this, Rob, because I guess I just never looked into it. Are the cases themselves, are they UV protected?
I would think so.
Because I've never seen anything that says they're UV protection.
Well, you've got a homework assignment to report back to us.
Yeah. If anyone knows that, let me know. That'd be pretty cool.
I would think so. I mean, but you know what they say about assumptions, right?
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
I want to get this nice back in the package for you.
James, you know that answer?
What?
About UV protection?
On graded slabs, are they slabs? Yeah, I think so too.
Okay.
Is it one of those things that kind of goes without saying?
I'm sure they, not every year, like if you have an old PSA 1 from like the 90s, they might not.
Now, you're going to have to bear with me. My OCD means I have to put these cards back. All right. Very cool. So thank you to BCW. So in addition to Panini Select Draft Picks NCAA Collegiate Football Cards, Panini Black NFL Football, Panini Select NBA, those new releases, and DC Hero DC Unlock the Multiverse Black Adam, all 4 of those are new releases this week, but we have a few other ones to tell you about in our Hot in the Shop segment. And we're going to kick it off with Panini Chronicles baseball cards. As you know, Chronicles from Panini America is a brand that combines 20 different programs for an incredibly unique collecting experience. With a variety of inserts and parallels, every box is going to have 3 autograph cards and 1 memorabilia card. And So some of the on-card autographs to be looking for, top rookies like Wander Franco, Matt Brash, O'Neill Cruz, and those are paired with memorabilia in Spectra rookie jersey autographs. Very cool. Chronicle Baseball also features autographs from top rookies and prospects like Josiah Gray, Bobby Witt Jr. Look for four different substrate types with substrate, just means stock. It's fancy for stock. Mix of C2S, Optichrome, holographic film board, and acetate in each pack. So incredible, diverse content. Look for clearly Donruss rated rookies. New brands rotated into Chronicles this year, Vertex, Marquee, and Essentials. And then with a taste of 19th century, look for the ultra rare insert Gold Rush, which just blazed by you there. Checklist is up on GoGTS.net. Check it out at Breakers and Retailers this week.
Great. 2022 Topps Update Series baseball cards. Fans of the game, get ready to complete your flagship collection. This series features rookies debuting in 2022, MLB game All-Star, and Home Run Derby participants, along with other modern day and legendary stars of America's pastime. There are two different configurations that you can go for, the hobby configuration, then also the jumbo configuration. So in the hobby, there's one autograph or relic card and one bonus silver pack in every box. And then the jumbo, you get one autograph card, one relic, and manufactured item card, plus one oversized box loader and two bonus silver packs in every box. The base set includes 330 cards, including recently traded players, rookies, rookie debut players, player combos. You get a bunch of different parallels. You get the gold foil, the rainbow, the black parallel, the clear variation. Bunch of different new inserts this year. Generation Now, Paragons of the Postseason, Diamond Greats Die Cuts, 2022 MLB All-Star Game, Topps Baseball, and then the returning favorite, you get the Topps Black Gold, if you remember those from the 1990s favorite inserts. Really, really cool. And then also you get autograph variation cards, some sketch cards, one of one hand-drawn art featuring MLB stars and legends. It's also very nice. Update series autograph relics. This thing is loaded. Update series autograph cards. So much great stuff in this. You get the checklists that are on the website at GoGTS.net. Check it out this week in stores.
Cool. Yeah, put a capstone to your flagship collection.
Absolutely.
Next up, 2022 Jersey Fusion All Sports Blaster Boxes. Pretty cool. One premium memorabilia card in every box. We've shown you Jersey Fusion product before. This is buyback cards infused with a piece of memorabilia, player or game worn. And each Jersey Fusion card comes in a custom acrylic archival insert and then is in a tamper evident Jersey Fusion card holder. And there's a unique QR code that links each card to a page showing the original jersey material from which it was taken, as well as the authentication, which is pretty cool. SP patch variation Jersey Fusions are one in 90 blaster boxes. And this is a really affordable price point. I don't know it off the top of my head, but I remember it zipping by through solicitations and going, it's a pretty solid deal. So check it out. This should be in select retailers. You can definitely find it at some of the online retailers.
All right, 2022 Leaf Multisport Solo Packs delivers one premium buyback card in every pack. Chase autographs, rookies, memorabilia cards, and more from a variety of sports and manufacturers. A fun, cost-effective rip designed as an entry-level product. Again, you get premium buyback card in every box. You get multiple sports, multiple manufacturers. Card values now They've ranged between $20 and $300. Pretty interesting. Affordable pricing, low barrier to entry. So you can see some of these cards that we're showing right here. Again, a lot of these are graded. Some are raw, like this one right here. This is a graded card of John Morant. You got a Jalen Green. Now, this is interesting. It's an autograph card. It's an authentic autograph. And then you got the Pedre here. Very nice. It's in stores this week. I should say probably it's a nice breaker-centric kind of product here. But check it out this week. Pretty cool product here.
Yeah, definitely. And then last but not least, we have a memorabilia product new from TriStar Hidden Treasures Autograph Football Helmets, Mini Helmets, rather, Series 2, a unique mix of Hall of Famers, Collegiate Stars, NFL Stars, Fan Favorites, and more. A version of this did release at the National, but this has some all new features and player selections. The case guarantees are 6 Hall of Famers, 3 football favorites, and 1 current star in every case. All autographs, as typical with TriStar products, are authenticated by either TriStar, PSA, JSA, or BAS. Look for everybody from Tom Brady to Joe Burrow, Devontae Adams, Jamar Chase, Micah Parsons, Chris Olave, Devontae Smith, and Hall of Famers like John Elway, Peyton Manning, and more. Also, collegiate star Bryce Young is in there. So check it out. Also look for full-sized memorabilia in the Touchdown Treasures. Those tickets are redeemable for full-size autograph memorabilia likes of Walter Payton, Joe Montana, Terry Bradshaw, Dan Marino, and more. And also is a great breaking product. So if some of your breakers that you tune into are probably going to be breaking this weekend if you want to get in on it. And that is a look at what's hot in the shop. All right. We have to put Chris to work pulling winners this evening. But we have we went out of order from our show notes earlier. So we've got 2 short video segments for you. The first one is a PSA surprise for Mike Trout. And then that's followed by, interestingly enough, since we've been heavy on the grading conversation tonight, CSG Grade School, where CSG Vice President Andy Broom teaches collectors how to grade the surface of a card. You want to pay attention to that. Watch this, and we'll be back to announce tonight's winners.
Here we go. Whoo! Jeez, this is nasty. You guys made this for me? Whoo! I'm getting chills right now. Oh, man. I'm lost for words right now. Oh, the rookies. Oh. Man, I appreciate this, guys. Whew. This is sick. I ain't gonna let my son touch this one yet. Wow. You know, I think when I first started collecting cards, you know, I didn't think it was gonna get this crazy, but I got involved quick and, you know, I got hooked quick. I think the hobby's real. One of the cooler things, you know, just to have your own pedigree. And, you know, I came up with a couple names with me and my wife. I want it to be a Trout thing. You know, I think if we have more kids in the future, I don't want it to be focused just on Beckham, obviously. It won't be fair. And, you know, we're a big sports family. You know, my family, you know, is big in sports, big Eagles fans, you know, obviously baseball. But it means a lot. And obviously PSA is the best in the business. To have them special cards that mean a lot to you in that pedigree, it means a lot to me. I didn't realize how many different cards are out there of mine. Obviously the rookies are good, but there's also cards in here with my friends, my wife, and, you know, special cards that mean a lot to me. A few years when Beckham, you know, realizes what's going on and knows that his dad plays professional baseball and starts collecting and being able to show to his friends and have a collection of his own, it means a lot. Whew, This is sweet, man. Can't wait to show my boys this.
Hi, I'm Andy Broom, Vice President of CSG. And in today's grade school, we're going to look at how to grade the surface of a card. So we're going to examine the surface of a card, and I'm going to show you how to look at it and how to pick up things such as wrinkles and dimples and other things that you may miss. Always start off with a good light source. So this particular lamp has an LED light bulb in it, so it gives you a nice clean white light. Now I want the light source to be facing directly down, and I'm going to start with the card perpendicular to the light source. And when I hold the card up to the lamp, I'm wanting to sheen it or run the reflection of the bulb over the surface of the card. And yes, it'll wash out the image of the card when looking at it, but what that does is it highlights any imperfections that may be on the surface, such as pinches, dimples, and even wrinkles and creases. And so while holding the card here at the light source, I'm just going to roll it in that light reflection, looking for any imperfections that may pop out. Then I'll also do that on the back as well. Now, by learning this trick, it's a great tool for pre-grading your cards, but it's amazing how much that you can miss, especially on the rear surface of the card, if you don't sheen it in the light like this. Now, the second thing I want to talk about the surface is how to clean the surface. You know, when you have a chrome type surface of a card, whether it's a Topps card, a Panini card, whatever it may be, these are very prone to fingerprints. And so we want to remove those fingerprints without damaging the surface of the card. So what I use is a microfiber cloth. And when I look at the surface and see an area that needs to be wiped, I just simply take it and wipe with the microfiber. This will not alter or scratch the surface in any way. And this will remove any type of foreign substance or fingerprints. Now, I do not recommend using any type of cleaners or chemicals to clean the surface of cards. These will oftentimes leave telltale signs behind and could cause your card to be returned as altered. Everything from microabrasion, which are tiny scratches, to the chemicals reacting to the surface of the card over time. All these things are detrimental to the card, and so we want to avoid them and just stick with a microfiber cloth. Get your cards graded at csgcards.com and follow us on social media at csgcards.
Very cool stuff, fun and educational. Pretty cool, a PSA. So without me even realizing it, there was definitely graded in the theme tonight.
Yeah. Good conversation. Yeah, a lot of graded conversation. But it's interesting. It's a very interesting conversation because everybody has their do's and don'ts when it comes to grading, and whether it's company or if they do it, if they don't do it, is it worth it? All that stuff.
Absolutely. All right. Well, we do have some winners to announce. I'll turn it over to you to give all the details and the winners.
Sure. So you guys know the deal here. So to claim your prize, you got to please email us at gogtslive@gogts.net. Please include your full name, your Twitter handle, your mailing address, and of course, what you won. I'll say that email address one more time, gogtslive@gogts.net. Very simple there. So we have a bunch of prizes to give away today, and we're going to start with the Hero DC Unlocked, the Multiverse Black Adam. We have two winners. We have one winner to get six packs of cards, and we have another winner who's going to get six packs of cards. And the first winner is going to be at @bballer2294. Congratulations. And the second winner is at @manual_djrh. Congratulations, guys. Thank you for watching tonight. 2022 Panini Select Draft Picks Collegiate Football Cards. And we will start with Tyler Goodson and a nice little variation or stack, whatever Rob pulled out for you of nice color cards that we pulled. And the Tyler Goodson and the color goes to @squiggle_D. Congratulations, Squiggle. And we have the Jalen Windermeyer. And then again, more color going to be included into this one. And this goes to @stung17. Congratulations there, Stung1. And we got the Kenneth Walker Gold. And then we have a Kenneth Walker Prism. pretty cool. And that goes to at Biggie2911. Congrats. And then the big one from the box, and this is the Kenny Pickett autograph card. This goes to at Zach N. Philly. Zach N. Philly. Congratulations there, Zach. All right. Moving on to 2022 Panini Black NFL football. And we will start with the Sky Moore jersey and the Mike Gesicki parallel. And that goes to at Bren Driss. Congratulations. Now we have the Derek Stingley autograph. And that goes to at Kristen951-86065. Congrats. And then now we have the Garrett Wilson autograph. And that goes to at Supernova Chris N. Congratulations, guys. Thank you again for watching this evening. And now we have 2021-22 Panini Select NBA Basketball. We had some really great hits out of this box as well. But we're going to start with the Raymond Felton jersey and a nice color stack that Rob's going to put together for you there. And this one goes to at Brian Staxton. Congratulations, Brian. Next, we have the Kai Jones auto. And again, another color stack that Rob is going to put together for you. This one goes to at Dan_K_Mitch. So Mitch is M-I-C-H. Congratulations there. So now we got the Cade Cunningham die cut out of 99, and then also the Cade Cunningham base rookie card that Rob is holding up right there for you. And this one goes to at TQuezada16. So it's TQUEZADA16. Congratulations. And now the big one. The big one is the Evan Mobley autograph out of 99. And this one goes to at MaddenGod6688. Congratulations, MaddenGod. And also, we have one last winner for this evening, and that is the great BCW interlocked and graded card frames. And the winner of that is at Fluke1994. It's not a fluke. You won at Fluke1994. Congratulations, guys. Again, thank you for watching tonight. And to claim your prize again, email us at GoGTSLive@GoGTS.net. Your full name, your Twitter handle, your mailing address, and of course, what you won. Thank you very much.
Couple quick programming notes. Our fearless technical producer needs a night off next week. So that means we will be off next week. We'll be returning on November 10th. And we'll have, as mentioned previously, part two of the interview with Jason and Enzo from Soccer Cards United, where they will provide their take and a preview of the FIFA World Cup. That's going to do it for us here at Go GTS Live, the Hobbies web show. Great job, Chris. Thank you, James, as always. Again, thanks to Daniel Carrier at US Playing Card and Scotty Prusha at Panini America. We'll be back in 2 weeks. Don't miss us too much. But in the meantime, you know what to be doing. Just be collecting. Night, everybody.